You're listening to the Unwritable Rant podcast with your host, author, and occasional misanthrope, Juliette Miranda. Go to theunwritablerant.com and you can subscribe on iTunes or connect with the show on Facebook and Twitter.
Well, hey there, y'all. It's Juliette Miranda. Welcome to episode number 52 of the Unwritable Rant podcast. Do you know what today is, y'all? Episode 52 is the one-year anniversary of the Unwritable Rant. I'm hearing no excuses. Get yourself a glass, fill it up with something amazing, I don't care what, and let's all raise our glasses up and say happy anniversary to the Unwritable Rant. Cheers, y'all.
It's no secret that Juliet enjoys a cocktail or two during the podcast. Here's a few of our favorite cocktail moments.
Wow. Oh, y'all, this is a bourbon with a bit of a kick. Whew, today, I am drinking Jack Daniel's Single Barrel Select Tennessee Whiskey. Oh, man, that is a tasty cocktail. Ugh, tequila. Oh, man, that is one hell of a good bourbon. Oh, man, that is good. That's one hell of a sweet cocktail. Oh, my favorite bourbon. Woohoo! This stuff's good. Now, in recognizing that this is the one-year anniversary of the Unwritable Rant, I knew I needed something to celebrate with. I didn't want to pick any old bourbon to share with y'all in this special episode. I went back and checked out everything that I drank throughout this entire year and picked up my very favorite. Now, y'all are always asking me, Juliette, what is your favorite thing to drink? And I'll tell you, over the past 12 months, the greatest bourbon that I had to drink, my favorite bourbon, would be Russell's Reserve Kentucky Straight Bourbon Whiskey. It really is, as far as I'm concerned, the perfect bourbon to drink. You can drink it neat, you can drink it on the rocks, both ways, it's going to have incredible flavor. Now, here's what I really like about it. It's got great flavor. It's a little bit toasted. It's got a little bit of flour to it, but it's got great spice and heat on the finish. So you know you're drinking a bourbon. The water just opens it up. You know, it gives it a little bit more of a lightness, a little bit more of a summery flavor to it. Either way, y'all, just drink this. Russell's Reserve, it's from the Wild Turkey family. It's outstanding. Coincidentally, my guy and I are also celebrating an anniversary in a couple of days. Yep, he and I have our 5-year wedding anniversary coming up. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with tales of our marital bliss. Nobody wants to hear about that. But I am going to say that it is an entire tremendous relief to have met somebody who compliments my own personal freak show. I mean, isn't that the best that anybody can ask for? And we're never going to find a perfect person. I don't think such a thing exists. But in my guy, I found somebody who not just compliments my freaky quirks, but celebrates them. Because I'll tell you, I wear those things proudly. Not that you all didn't realize that already. But my point being, I wasn't going to show up on our first date and not be who I was. Because I didn't want to get to this point where we are today and have him suddenly look at me and go, "Why are you drinking bourbon at 11 o'clock in the morning?" I want a guy who's going to look at me and say, "Why didn't you get me a glass too?" Now see, that's the thing that makes dating such a truly miserable experience. Because a lot of people, in fact, I would say the majority of people out there in the dating pool, they don't have that courtesy. They may be freaks and weirdos, but they're going to let you get to know the fake version of them first. They're going to let you think you're getting one thing, and then, oh, I don't know, 3 dates, 4 dates, 4 years later, they're going to turn into somebody else who's entirely different and sticky and gross and nobody that you want to know. Ugh, like this one guy. I will call him the Count because I certainly don't want to give you his name for fear that he comes oozing back into my life somehow. This guy, a real winner. He was one of those guys I found on Match.com back in the day. A good on paper kind of guy whose facade rapidly scabs and crumbles with the slightest bit of picking. But not that I knew this at the time, because he presented himself well. You know, I was naive enough to look at his presentation, his impressive Match.com profile, and think that maybe I had scored the one intelligent and attractive artist in the pool when I saw that first email he sent to me. And he certainly did have an impressive range of interests, I'll tell ya. He liked French poetry, and he'd actually read it, you know, not absorbed it from, you know, watching the movie about the Doors. He liked Italian art, photography, motorcycles, travel. We'd even read some of the same obscure philosophers. And that's actually kind of what, you know, cinched the deal for me when he asked if we could meet for coffee. You know, my reasoning was that if he could discuss Schopenhauer at any length, you know, he may not have had as many, latent maniacal tendencies. Wasn't that just cute of me? Just so optimistic, like a bunny rabbit? Now, the guy that I wanted to meet was kind of like a worldly charmer. You know, somebody that I'd find in a dusty bookstore in Italy. I was really hoping that Val Kilmer would show up, you know, as he was in the movie The Saint. You know, just that smart, handsome, kind of dashing guy. Well, what I got was not Val Kilmer in The Saint. What I got was Bela Lugosi at the height of his heroin addiction and the Dracula from Sesame Street. The Count just had this, I don't even know how to explain it, just a weird sort of aura about him. Now, initially, I thought that I might have just been overreacting to his accent. It was this weird, forced combination of several European inflections, you know, kind of like what you would think a swarthy used Ferrari salesman would sound like. It was weird. But I wanted to be open-minded. I didn't want to be too critical or too harsh, because up until that point, I'd only been dating really, really awful, horrible musicians. You know, the kind of musician who was more Peter Pan than human being, you know, whose idea of a romantic gesture was allowing me to write his press releases or, you know, be the head of his fan club. So you can understand why I really wanted to like the Count. Although all these weird little issues just kind of oozed to the surface. And my first hint that he may have been harboring something less than savory in his dirty little closet was an answer that he gave me to a completely casual question I asked about his painting. Now, he told me that he painted every day. So I asked, well, how do you handle artistic block? You know, because, you know, me as a writer, I get it. I can stare at a blank screen for hours. So I wanted to know what he did, if that happened to him in a canvas. Now, I can't do accents to save my life, y'all, so I'm not even going to try. But I'm going to tell you what he said, and I want you to picture the Count from Sesame Street and the way that he would count. Just think of that fake European accent. So I ask him the question, and he responds, ah, yes, I too have that problem. But I try to work in small bursts, and I reward myself with an onanism session whenever I accomplish something. Do y'all know what onanism means? Now, I had a hunch, but I wasn't entirely sure, so I made a mental note, and back at home, I checked it out in my Webster's. I just knew it wasn't going to be good. And of course, lo and behold, I found out that on our very first date, the Count had told me that he jerks off whenever he paints. I was repulsed and weirdly intrigued. I admit it. It was just such an unusual way of saying it. I honestly couldn't decide if he was being sleazy or exhibiting some kind of, bizarre European honesty. But this guy, the Count, he wasn't American by birth. He'd spent a ton of time traveling abroad. So I just imagined or fancied or whatever my delusional brain came up with, some sort of culture gap. And that's why I was having a hard time judging his character. And of course, it didn't help that I was still clinging to my morbidly romantic hope that he and I could someday share a bottle of wine in the rain while trading Baudelaire quotes. And since I had these crazy notions, I decided to go on two more dates with him. Now, they were fine. And then on our fourth date, I'm thinking, all right, I'm feeling comfortable with him. He hasn't freaked me out. He hasn't dropped any more freaky words on me. I agree to allow him to pick me up at my apartment. Well, he greets me at the door. He's very polite and cordial, and he hands me a stack of papers. And he says, these are for your reading pleasure, but please, please do not read them now. I cannot bear for you to read them in front of me. Well, whatever, buddy. I threw him on the table, I grabbed my coat, and I allowed him to take me to an art museum for the afternoon. And again, it was a decent time. He didn't try anything. In fact, he wasn't even holding my hand. So I thought, all right, maybe this is kind of a friendship. Maybe he is just a regular guy who wants to hang out with a chick. So with that in my head, I saw no reason to invite him back into my apartment after our date for a drink. Now, again, our bodies had connected no further than a hug up until that point. And I had absolutely no intention of having sex with him. Really, all I wanted to do was sit down, share a bottle of wine, and get to know him better. And I told him this specifically. Before we even got out of his car, I said this. And again, picture that crazy Count Dracula voice in your head when I say that he told me, of course I understand, mon chéri. I too just want to know you better. Well, all right, great. So we go into the apartment and I offer him a glass of wine. And this is where things get a little weird, because he tells me then and there that he doesn't drink at all. Well, I was a little suspicious then. I didn't really understand why he wasn't a drinker, but whatever, so be it. He'd killed half of my fantasy right then and there, but that's all right. I was going to see it through. I decided to start making tea. So he's watching me in the kitchen as I'm moving around, getting mugs for our tea and offering him sugar or whatever he wants in it. And he's got this weird expression on his face. It's one of mystical wonder. And he tells me that I remind him of his mother. He says, "Oh, my mother, she is such a beautiful woman, and you are just the exact perfection of a woman, just like my mother." And that takes me aback a little bit, because nobody wants to be compared to somebody's mother. So I decide to make a little bit of conversation. I say, "Oh, your mother, you know, where does she live?" And he says, "Oh, well, I live with my family. We all live just south of here." And I said, "You all live?" He goes, "Oh, yes, yes, I live with my mother and my father and my brothers." And I go, "How old are you?" Well, it turns out, of course, that he is 35, living at home with his family, while employed, gainfully employed, and doing all of this by choice and enjoying it. Well, that was enough for me. Every single internal alarm that I had started screaming in unison, and I realized, just like a ball of fire in the night, the Count was not an international man of mystery. He was a creepy artist in residence looking for his own personal Madonna to defile. And he starts inching closer to me. He's starting to get that sexy talk voice on. And he leans in and he puts his hand on mine and he goes, "Tell me about your eroticism. I believe that under your demure exterior, you are something more. Tell me, my love, have you ever been DP'd?" Now, I'm still processing all of the nonsense, all of the scuzzy nuggets that he's dropped in my lap up until this point. And fight or flight is starting to kick in. And I'm thinking, what do I do? Do I introduce him to the baseball bat under my sofa? Do I answer him? Where do I look? Who do I call? What now? And somehow, I had the most random, ridiculous response of all. I started laughing. And he looks at me questioningly, like I had somehow deflated the most illuminating thought question he could ever ask me. And he goes, "Please, you do not want to answer my question?" So I go, "Are you fucking kidding me?" Well, he looks a little bit offended and he goes, "Oh, but I believe this is something that you would truly enjoy." Well, again, I laughed and he had the cheek to look offended, like he really wanted to see what was in my soul by asking me if I had been double penetrated. Well, there was no way in the world I was going to bridge whatever freak show divide existed between us. So I look at him and I go, "All right, buddy, it's time for you to leave." Well, I got him out the door pretty quickly, and I just sat down with my head in my hands. So much for my foreign fantasy man. Well, I'm getting up, right, because I want a shot of whiskey, and I notice the pile of papers that he had left for me earlier. I pick them up and start skimming them, and I realize that it is 10 random pages from a book that he's writing about the loves of his life. And the first two pages detail how he got over his fear of peeing in public. Well, I immediately filed his phone number under Do Not Answer, and then I grabbed my copy of The Saint, that movie that I had loved so much and lusted after, and I threw that fucking thing right in the fireplace. And with that, I need some more bourbon. Hang on, y'all.
Let's listen in to some outtakes of Juliette's sweet, sultry voice.
God damn it, I'm really fucking nasally. I don't like this. All right, let's try it one more time. Get yourself a big old put. God damn it. Blah. So I do, and then sitting in the middle of the... God damn it. No, wait, scratch that. Blah. So what do you say? Get a glass, let's raise them up, and let it... Blah. Oh, so close. So very close. Well, that was a... Blah. All right, hang on, I'm going to do that again. Fuck a duck. Well, that was unimpressive. I already said spectacular. A plate of mama's chicken sounded ab-blah. And upon a blah. Son of a bitch, I'm falling apart. Oh, happy anniversary to me. You know, like I was saying, it is so awesome to have my guy compliment my wacky traits. Although that doesn't mean that we don't still find ways to surprise each other. The other day, in fact, my guy and I were just hanging out on the driveway doing what we do best when we started feeling a little restless. Well, we're looking at each other and thinking, all right, you know, do we call an Uber? Do we head to the casino? Do we maybe find a street fair? But the problem was we were also feeling lazy. Restless, lazy, and a little drunk. That's a dangerous combination, y'all. So I suggest to my guy that we go for a walk. I'm thinking, all right, maybe we'll stumble into the tequila bar, maybe hit the pub for some burgers. And he's game. So we gather up all of our gear, throw it in the garage, and then head on out to the so-called main street of our town. Well, there, looming in the horizon, just a block or two down the road, is the glorious red glow of Target. And my guy and I look at each other as if that was our destination all along, and we both nod and start walking towards that gorgeous red beacon. Now, Target is a little bit of a problem for me, regardless of my sobriety. There's just so much stuff in there. And we have one of those great Targets, one of those super Targets that has everything you could possibly want, from groceries to, oh, I don't know, chainsaw parts to automotive crap. It's a wonderland. So I knew we were going to get into some sort of mischief. I just didn't know exactly how or what. And who would have thought it would be my guy to cause it? We walk into those front doors, and I see my guy eyeballing the row of motorized shopping carts to the right. He has been fascinated and in awe of those things since we started going to Target. Now, you know the ones, right? It's kind of like a golf cart with a shopping cart built into it. They're designed for people with mobility issues. You know, people who don't have the wherewithal to manage the wide aisles of Target and the miles of shopping that lay ahead of them. That description, of course, does not apply to my guy. Or me, really. And maybe that's why my guy acquired a sudden case of spontaneous clubfoot. He announces this to me very seriously, and I don't think he knows what clubfoot is, but that didn't stop him. He had it bad, so bad that he needed to hop into one of these shopping carts and drive himself through the store. Well, these things are pretty simple to operate, but it took my guy a couple of tries to get the hang of it, and of course, in the process, he backs over an entire display of tissues, leaving me to put them back together again. And by the time I'm done, of course, he's traversed the entire length of the store, cased it out, and decided that he wants to hit the grocery section. Well, I'm trailing after him like a rejected circus performer, watching him as he eyeballs things at the very top of the shopping shelves. And he looks up at me with those puppy dog eyes, all whimpering and sad, and he goes, "Could you reach something for me up there? Because, you know, my foot really hurts and I can't do it myself." I roll my eyes, I grab what it is he wants and throw it in the cart and start following after him as he tears off down the aisle. But we play that game a couple more times and it's starting to wear on me a little bit. And then we roll into the cereal and cookie aisle. This aisle is jam-packed with ladies and their children. But they're polite. They see my guy in his cart and assume there's something wrong with him. And there is, of course, but not what they think. So he rolls on up to the cookies. And he knows I hate prepackaged cookies. I hate them from the depths of my soul because I think they're disgusting. I can make cookies a million times better than anything you're going to buy in Target. And he knows this, of course. So he looks up at me and says, rather loudly so everybody can hear, "Could I please have some cookies?" So I look at him and I go, "Oh, what cookies do you want?" And he goes, "Those." And he points up at the Oreos at the very top of the shelf. Well, everybody's kind of watching us, right? And I look at him and I go, "No, you are not getting cookies." And of course, my guy plays this up to his advantage because he sees people watching and he sees me getting a little angry and he hears the anger in my voice. So he reacts dramatically. He throws his hands over his head and he goes, "Please don't hit me." Well, if those ladies could call DCFS on me, they would have. They were shocked. They're staring at me as if I'm about to start beating my husband like a rug. And one do-gooder, one lady who clearly feels she's better than me, walks over, grabs the Oreos off the top of the shelf, and she goes, "Here you go, honey. Here are your cookies." And he bats his eyes at her and he goes, "Oh, thank you." He's like, "I hurt my foot, so I couldn't get them myself, and she didn't want to get any. Thanks, love." And as he's saying this, he's winking at me, right? He's giving me one of his subtle little grins and flashing that dimple at me so only I can see that this is one big game and he is enjoying it thoroughly. And of course, it continues throughout the store. Him riding up and down the hallways and randomly yelling out things like, "Why don't you love me anymore?" He really is pulling his best Betty Davis and Joan Crawford and Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. And of course, me, I'm the crazy one who's going, "If you don't stop it, you're going to get the hose when we get home." And then he's playing it up going, you wouldn't treat me like this if I could walk. And everybody hears us. Everybody knows, of course, that I'm the monster and my poor, handsome husband is confined to his rolling cart through Target. And then I realize something that my husband has forgotten. And I wasn't going to tell him about it, but I certainly was going to exploit it. Now we pull up to the checkout counter. And as we pull up, the girl is about to turn her light off to close up the lane. But she sees my guy rolling up in his cart, the cart that he didn't need, of course, and says, oh, no, don't worry. I'll keep the lane open for you. Of course she is, because my husband is impossible to resist. He has charm like you wouldn't believe. So he's batting his eyes and he's thanking her. And I'm going, oh, baby, you have no idea what's coming next, do you? We check out, you know, we start rolling. And then my guy pulls his cart over to the corral where they belong. And just as he gets out of it, as both of his feet hit the floor and he stands up, I drop to my knees, I throw my hands to the heavens, and I yell, praise the Lord, my husband can walk again. Oh, baby, you're healed. You're healed. And my husband realizes his dramatic faux pas because everybody now is staring at him, that faker. And that whole time, I am doing it up brown. I'm going, Lord, you healed my husband. You healed my husband. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that. Baby, walk. Walk, baby. I know you can do it. Well, my guy starts walking out the door like the Lord commanded him to. And he grabs my hand as we're walking out and he looks at me and he goes, well played, my love. Well played. And that, y'all, is why I love my guy. So I am raising up my glass right now and I am toasting to my awesome guy. Happy anniversary, love. Now, before I let y'all go, I just want to say thank you to everybody who's been listening to this podcast for the past year. It's an idea that was born out of driveway drinking and conversation with my guy and the thought that, who knows, maybe this is something that'll work. So I really appreciate all of you who've been listening, who have helped share it, who have told your friends, who have subscribed and left reviews. Really, thank you. Now, a couple of you have been tremendously supportive right from the very beginning of the show, and I just want to give you all a very special thank you, particularly Ray from Naked Porch, Courtney from the Quadcast podcast, S. Anthony Thomas and the S. Anthony Show, the wacky guys over at Super Peepee Time, Three is Comedy, and the Epic Film guys. Y'all have been so very cool, and I've had the best time getting to know you and listening to your show, so thank you once again for your support. And with that, y'all, I got some celebrating to do. I'll talk with you again next week. Cheers.